Okay, we're going to talk politics this morning, but maybe not in a way that you've thought of. Now, Steve Raby is a political consultant. Your company, Direct Communications, mm-hmm. does a lot of polling yeah. for political candidates.
Yeah.
And I think you are nonpartisan in that effort.
True.
So you work for candidates from whatever party.
Yeah.
That's something you've done for a long time. Now, I just thought of you. We have done this interview before, and we did it about polling because mm-hmm. you know a lot about it. And this a few years ago when polling badly predicted different races, and so we tried to nail that down mm-hmm. why that was. Well, anyway, you worked. We're going to get into something that you and I chatted about. You worked for Mac McCutcheon, mm-hmm. the former Speaker of the House of yes. Representatives in the state of Alabama. And you also consulted with his replacement, Nathaniel Ledbetter,
right.
who is the new Speaker. And you were talking about the fact, you mentioned the word hyper-partisan politics. Let's talk about partisan politics first. What politics is by its nature partisan.
Yes.
So when you say hyper-partisan, what does that mean to you?
Hyper-partisanship means the both political parties yeah. have reached a point where only their party's right and the other side is wrong. And it's beyond just a ideology trying to come to conclusions or problem yeah. solving, is that partisan is the only thing that matters. Okay. And that's the point we've reached today.
Okay, and one of the things you said about both Mac McCutcheon and Nathaniel Ledbetter is that is not where they are as politicians.
No, both are problem solvers. Okay. And
they're partisan. But they're more
yeah, they're very good Republicans, but they see issues and problems and try to reach resolutions.
Okay, so in polling, what does polling say about the American people, even in a red state like Alabama, yeah. or a blue state like does it say about what voters want? Do they want hyper-partisan politics?
Well, let's divide that. What voters want versus what they perceive. Just looking at a national polling firm, yeah. Pew Research, they have determined that 80% of Americans believe that Democrats and Republicans cannot agree on basic facts.
Yeah.
And the majority of the people in the United States and the majority of the people in Alabama certainly feel there's too much partisanship. They want to tone it down and let's solve problems.
Well, then, if that's what the people want, I'm always intrigued by, well, the people want this, but they're getting a steady diet of that. How come when polling indicates one thing that the politicians don't move in that direction? Or maybe they do, it just doesn't appear that way
yeah.
to me.
Well, that's what people want virtually what they do or ultimately do, you know, sort of confined by the choices they have.
Yeah.
And part of the problem is most times you only have a choice between the Democratic candidate and the Republican yeah. candidate. And if you look at what has happened and the causes of hyper-partisanship, again, it's not what the people want, but it's what decision makers have done. Basically, there's no reward for a politician who presents themselves as a problem solver because you've got to win a primary to
yeah.
get there. I think gerrymandering or the drawing of congressional districts and legislative districts has a lot to do with it because they're drawn in such a way
yeah.
that they're super partisan. And the results of that, you know, we have one just north of us, a great example. Jim Cooper, who was chairman of the Armed Services Committee,
yeah.
a Democrat and a conservative guy. This past year, the Republican-controlled legislature divided his district three ways,
yeah.
so he couldn't get elected. Now, he was a problem solver, had achieved a level of leadership, and it didn't matter. You know, he was drawn out of his district. I think the evolution of media, and I'm not here to point fingers.
Although
we're
going to talk about not
yeah.
well, maybe I don't know if you're talking about traditional media or.
Well, I'm saying across the board. Yeah, you've
yeah.
got traditional media. You look at it. Let's go back 80s to and watch the evolution. If you looked at CNN at the time, they came up with a program, Crossfire, to bring in the debate, okay? Yeah. And if you'll think back, starting in the early 80s, they bring on people and they want some confrontation, they want some discussion. Yeah. But observing, because I was chief of staff for a very conservative Democratic senator, and I saw him and his Republican counterpart on the show. Well, they asked Judge Heflin a question about immigration, and he deferred to Alan Simpson, the Republican on the committee, to answer the question. They asked Alan Simpson a question about something on judicial reform. He deferred to Heflin as a former Chief Justice. Well, these guys were actually legislators. They were making decisions. You know, were they ever invited back again? No. So what people saw, the younger folks that had a hyper-partisan relationship, and it generated more viewers. You know, we can't forget that media, it's a financial enterprise. Yeah. You've got to make money. But as that evolved, where it was the choice of one cable system, you got more choices. Yeah. And then in the era of streaming, you had more platforms. Yeah. And so those are the things that became echo chambers. And it just further divides, and people don't hear two sides of an issue.
There's so many ways to go with this. You know, once upon a time when there were strong community newspapers, people would read, they would read all the stuff they wanted to read. That was a theory anyway. They would read the stuff they wanted to read. Then they would get around to reading the stuff they needed to read.
Correct.
Well, we've kind of gone that way, haven't we, with our other media?
Oh, absolutely.
And that we don't, we only want what we want to read.
Right.
We don't. We're not checking out the stuff we don't want to read.
Reporters are not rewarded or paid unless people click on their stories. And so you can spend weeks, you know, doing a great story, and if nobody comes on, there's no reward for it. So why waste your time doing that in the future? And that's hard.
Okay, so, and social media has only made it worse.
Yeah. Again, it becomes an echo chamber, and it just either confirms or reaffirms what you're thinking, and gives you, instead of looking at an issue.
Yeah.
We see some of it as dysfunction on the organization of the House, but some elements of what the extreme conservatives were presenting, I think has been part. Members of Congress have surrendered their power to leadership.
Yeah.
And so we talk about why do people get something. Look at the omnibus appropriations bill that was all 13 appropriation bills. You had a choice, up or down. Nobody had a chance to debate the defense appropriations or commerce appropriations. And so as members have just surrendered their power, it becomes more partisan or more team. You're either for this one or you're against that one. And there's no room for members of Congress to get in and debate solutions.
Okay, is it, we hear what politicians want us to hear.
Right.
I'm not gonna ask you for any specifics, but in their private conversations, do they understand that this is not, at least I don't think it is, a winning formula for having a good government?
Right.
Do they understand that they need to be like those guys on Crossfire and, you know, trusting the other legislator to know something and to have some good ideas?
Yeah, most of the members and political elected officials I deal with in Alabama, they'll have those private conversations. How do we resolve issues? But certain issues get certain supporters, and they get so much attention, so leaders have to address that at some point. And you know, you can get into, but the impact it has, and I don't mean to get political, but I'm going to use an example. You know, CRT, or critical race theory, becomes an issue. And I'm just looking at sort of, you know, the time period when I was in Washington versus now. This issue comes up. The governor says, we don't teach that in schools. The state superintendent says, we don't teach that in schools. All local superintendents, whether they're elected or appointed, says, guys, we don't teach that in schools. Principals tell people, we don't teach that in schools. But members of the legislature want to pass it. So, effectively, you're tearing down those institutions. They're saying, Steve, don't believe the institutions. They're not telling you the truth. We've got to pass a law.
Yeah.
Well, you know, 30 years ago, leadership would have just stood up and said, the governor said we don't teach it. Move on.
Yeah.
And that doesn't exist anymore.
Okay. Is there polling about that? I mean, obviously every voter doesn't see it the way maybe I see it.
Right.
But that has to be when we got a thing here where, and I hate to use this, the alternative fact thing.
Yeah.
You know, where there's a truth, and then there's a truth that you're being told by people running for political office,
mm-hmm.
Who need you to believe a particular
yeah.
thing.
We can't blame the media,
yeah.
and we can't necessarily always blame the politicians,
yeah.
because ultimately it's still a democracy. It resides
yeah.
with us, the people. But again, you get into to those echo chambers, and I could also spend 20 minutes talking about this, but I will offer it quickly. There was a study, I think it was Ohio State and I believe Yale Law School,
okay.
Well, it didn't start as politics, but the emphasis of the study was, do facts matter, okay? And the short story of that is that years ago, I could ask you a question,
yeah.
and you have a preconceived notion, and it may be something like what your mother told you aspirin would do, okay?
Yeah.
I show you evidence. This is what doctors say, American Medical Association. Folks say, oh, okay, I didn't realize that.
Yeah.
And the area that people would not look at facts
yeah.
used to be in the realm of religion.
Yeah.
Okay. Over the last 40 years, that has moved to politics. Somebody can have a notion in politics, and you show them some simple facts, it's not accepted. So if that's the biggest problem with hyper-partisanship, is there's no agreement on the basic facts. And
yeah.
and so a solution is not what you perceive or what I perceive, and no legislative body builds on what has done. Just like this week, what did the Congress do? They voted to overturn sections of that omnibus appropriations. Well, you know that's not going to become law. The Senate's not going to pass it, the President's not. Again, that's the use of legislation not to solve problems, but to have a win.
Okay. Okay, as a guy who's been involved in this game for a while, I mean, now we're down the last couple of minutes. So
yes, I'm sorry.
No. Is there a solution? Is there a way out of this place where we've gotten ourselves, where problem solvers aren't the ones we want in office? How do we get away from where we are now and get back to functioning legislation?
It's got to be up to the people, and they've got to exercise that opinion at a ballot box. And when are they given that opportunity?
Yeah.
And it is interesting. One thing that I'll share with you, that at least people, I see this nationwide, but even in Alabama, people used to identify themselves almost like 55% Republican,
yeah.
35% Democrat, and that's where. In this last election cycle, that self-identification is moving almost evenly, almost a third, say, Republican, a third now independent, and a third
okay.
Democrat. And until that group defines themselves, not just how they define themselves, but look for facts and
okay.
search for solutions.
Is it possible to think that the American people are just saying, you know, not only am I tired of the stuff, I'm going to start trying to figure out how not to have it? And you say it's up to us.
Yeah.
Is there any reason to think that we are taking a proactive hand in this, that we're trying to do something to make our government work better?
Well, I think the general measure there would be participation in presidential races.
Yeah.
And you will see the group that defines themselves traditionally as independents has been shrinking up until this last election cycle, and then it started
okay.
growing. And those independents voted against the incumbent or voted
okay.
against extremism.
Okay, so I think what you're saying is the more independents out there, the better our government might work.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's a matter
yeah.
of if policy and
yeah.
problem solving
yeah.
is your issue. look at policy and problem solving, not just look at a Democrat or a Republican.
Okay, let's go back to the politicians you work with.
Yep.
Most of them, I'm just making a broad generalization,
right.
Most of them would rather be problem solvers.
Yeah, yes.
They're just kind of caught up in what the situation.
Right. Yeah, well, look at one of the things that both Speaker Ledbetter and Speaker McCutcheon did. They pushed for the infrastructure bill. A lot of people see that as gas tax. Well, we have a faction in the state that's just working just to overturn the gas tax or to defeat anybody that voted for that. Instead of look at the infrastructure construction that's going on. Let's build on that and move on. Okay. Let's don't go back and rehash something from 3 years ago. And that is frustrating, that whenever you reach a solution, it's no longer a solution because it was your idea. It wasn't mine.
Okay.
And that's tough.
Okay. God, we could talk about this for days.
Yeah.
we will have you back in. Thank you very much for being here.
Well, I appreciate it very much, Steve.